to me.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to find out what turmeric, apples, and grapes have in common from a study at Texas, University of Texas. And we have about 15 more original, high-quality studies, always published in peer-reviewed journals with major citations. And I say that, and I give you for decades, I've given you the background so that you know that this information is of quality, because back in the 1970s, I was told by a stranger, met him once, never again, and he met me outside the radio station. I didn't know who he was. I just thought he was a listener, came over to say hello. And he said, no, I'm a part of a group. I'm a group of six people working within the pharmaceutical industry on the Null problem. I said, what's the Null problem? Well, you're kind of being considered the Ralph Nader of health, and you keep saying things about what's wrong with pharmaceuticals and a lot of other things that could cause people to shift over, and you're also a crossover. What do you mean I'm a crossover? Well, you're popular in the health field, but you're also popular in the mainstream. You have these monster best-selling books. You're on Mike Douglas and Johnny Carson, Merv Griffin, all these shows. And so people are taking you seriously. And these people are threatened. So they're going to do all they can. Why are you telling me this? Because after working three straight years on everything about your life, going to your hometown, interviewing the people you grew up with, trying to see if you did drugs or were a troublemaker, anything and everything I could, I can't find any problems. And I just felt, this is wrong. But they're going to do something to you. And one of the things they'll do is they'll try to make it seem like you're giving misinformation or unqualified information. And they're setting you up for some debates, including a national debate. And he said, you do have a national debate coming, don't you? And no one knew that, by the way. No one knew that I was going to be on a national program debating. And he said, is the person you're going to be debating? He gave me the person's name. I said, yes. He said, well, they're going to keep emphasizing they have science, you don't. So from now on, wherever you go, always take peer-reviewed scientific literature with you that can be used to support your position. Because remember, this isn't about you, Gary. It's about all those millions of people who want to be healthier. And because you're young and an idealist, they're going to follow your advice. So if they can discredit you, then they can, in fact, stop a movement. I thanked him. I didn't know if he was legitimate or not. He told me some other things that no one knew about contracts I had and how they had destroyed the contracts by going behind the scenes with publishers and ABC Network. No one knew that. And so that's why every single day when I come on the air, everything I mention is based upon quality PubMed peer-reviewed literature from respected institutions, so you can believe the information. You could use this in a court of law. So I just want to share that with you, because some people say, why do you go? We don't need to know this. Yeah, you do. Now, also today, because I only got halfway through my article yesterday where I was challenging with Jimmy Wells and trying to deconstruct who is Jimmy Wells that would allow him to have such animus and such bias against all, no exceptions, the entire field of alternative and complementary medicine. We have hundreds of thousands of studies supporting what we use in PubMed. And so until you know who he is, what his background is, what he believes in, then you don't know why he might be biased. Well, we wrote a letter yesterday to the entire board of directors and trustees and officers of Wikipedia and Wikimedia Foundation. And I will read that letter to you later. We will post it. Send it to every legislator you know. Send it to your state's attorney general. Send it to your secretary of state. It is our belief that they should have their nonprofit status challenged, and they definitely should have Congress rescind the indemnifications so they couldn't be sued. They should be sued. and they will be sued. So I'm going to read you that letter. But because a lot of people in this audience don't have access to computers or not highly computer literate, when I told people, finish reading the article on the internet, some of the people where I'm at with our anti-aging study said, I'm glad you read stuff over WBAI because, you know, we don't use the internet. Okay, so I'm going to finish reading it so you'll be fully informed as well. Does it seem at all ironic that supposedly liberal stations like CNN and MSNBC and others would use known deep state intelligence operatives as commentators and hire them, like Clapper and the other people within the intelligence community? Does it seem ironic that they will use those formed with Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton and Nancy Pelosi, all these other people saying that we should arrest and try for treason people like Julian Assange and Edward Snowden? And yet all they did was expose corruption. They did not create corruption. And the people that they showed were making illegal actions and were corrupt were not even brought up in the conversations. So just imagine that you stop a bank robbery and the police decide you should be arrested and they let the robber go free and he's allowed to take or she whatever they stole. That's how insane this is. Now, if you think this is an exaggeration, we're going to play you a segment today from a CIA station chief talking about what's going on right now with the deep state. And I also found a clip of the CIA admitting, the head of the CIA, the director of the CIA, admitting that they're using all the major news to manipulate American minds. Yeah, we have that. So that's what's going on. Also, there's a glaring engineering mistake that made wind turbines inefficient. We're going to talk about that. So everything that's green is not always compatible with our desires. And we'll go into what we should really be doing that we can make a difference with. So that's our show. We have a lot to cover. I won't cover everything. We won't have time, but I'll get as much in as possible. Prostate cancer is among the leading cancers in men in the United States, second only to skin cancer. The American Cancer Society estimates that 174,650 new cases and 31,620 deaths from prostate cancer occur every year in the United States. Fortunately, new evidence suggests that eating certain foods could play a role in starving or even preventing cancer. It's a natural roadblock for cancer. Now, this research was done at the University of Texas at Austin, and it identified several natural compounds found in foods such as red grapes, apple peels, the skin of apples, and turmeric, T-U-R-M-E-R-I-C, and onions that can thwart the growth of prostate cancer. The study was published in the peer-reviewed journal Precision Oncology, and it found that specific combinations of these compounds had the potential to shrink prostate tumors. Now, previous studies have also identified compounds, particularly those found in plant-based foods, that can reduce the risk of prostate cancer because they have chemicals that can block the cancer or cancer pathways. And these would also include your cruciferous. And that's why every day I make sure I get cruciferous vegetables into my diet. Broccoli, cauliflower, collard greens, kale, mustard, which is very good. It's a condiment, but it's very anti-cancer, antibacterial, and antiviral. And radishes, yeah, watercress. So that's what they're doing. And they found that they tested 142 phytochemicals on murine and human cells with the aim of identifying which natural compounds are most effective at inhibiting the growth of prostate cancer. And that's what they came up with. Now, also, they found that ursolic acid, that's U-R-S-O-L-I-C, ursolic acid in apple peels and rosemary, resveratrol found in berries and red grapes, and curcumin found in turmeric. So let's just see what you could do. You could take an apple, four apples, and you peel the apples. You can juice the apples once they're peeled, but you throw the skins in a blender. You can throw a teaspoon of rosemary powder in there. Or if you have fresh rosemary, that's fine too. You can let's say, a cup to a bowl of grapes in there, red grapes, blue grapes, black grapes. And you can put a quarter teaspoon of curcumin in there, or about 1,000 milligrams. And then take some your favorite liquid, whether it's orange juice, grapefruit juice, apple juice, and rice milk, and you blend that and drink that down, and now you got everything they said was really good for prostate cancer if you're a man. And just keep in mind, every food that you eat in its natural state contains anywhere from 75 to 300 or 400 different phytonutrients. And this is what really happens when it goes into our body and they break down and then they're recombined and they can actually starve the cancer cells to death. And that's important. In fact, one of the most important things you could take for your prostate, men, and you probably have never heard this, glutamine. You've heard of Africanum pygium. You've heard of saw palmetto, stinging nettles, genistein, and those are all correct. But the reality is that you could prevent prostate cancer cells from consuming all the wrong all the wrong inflammatories by making sure that you are having a lot of fruits and vegetables in your diet. Now, from St. Michael's Hospital, as well as the University of Calgary, published in the Annals of Internal Medicine, if you have dementia, then non-pharmacologic treatments could be more effective. That's right. It's rare to find something like this. So what am I saying? I'm saying that for patients with dementia who have symptoms of aggression and agitation, interventions such as taking them outdoors, giving them massages, and touch therapy can be more effective treatments than medication in many cases. How do we know? Because there was a systematic review of a meta-analysis, meaning many studies on the same topic reviewed to see what were common phenomena. And it shows that outdoor activities were more clinically effective than antipsychotic medication for treating physical aggression in patients with dementia. Just letting them get out and walk and play, whatever you can do with them outside, getting them into a pool and letting them move around a swimming pool, taking them to the beach and let them take off their shoes, walk in the sand, then giving them head massages, back massages, touch therapy, reflexology. Now, they're good quality therapists, reflexologists, and they're trained in how to manipulate the different meridian points on the feet that relate to every other parts of the body. For example, if a person's having a headache or tension around the neck, around the top of the toes, that corresponds to that area. So doing that couple times a week would be terrific for them. And by the way, millions of Americans suffer from dementia at the beginning, middle, or later stages. From the Karolinska Institute in Sweden, published in the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine, comes a study about high-intensity hatha yoga, hatha, H-A-T-H-A, and anti-inflammatory and lipid-improving effects. So when you do yoga, specifically hatha yoga, you can turn off inflammation in your body and improve your cholesterol and triglyceride levels. So that's good. Something that simple. It also lowers blood pressure, helps you recover your heart rate after exercising. All good things come from that. And from Rutgers University comes a study that mindfulness can reduce opiate cravings. That's right. People suffering from opiate addiction and chronic pain may have fewer cravings and less pain if they use both mindfulness techniques and whatever the standard treatment is for opiate dependence to get them off that. This was published in Drug and Alcohol Dependence. Now, the fact that they're even acknowledging complementary therapies as adjunctive to the main therapy in and of itself is a breakthrough. In fact, I'd be willing to bet that it is the complementary therapy and not the main therapy that is making the difference. oxygen in hyperbaric chambers provides relief after radiotherapy. This is from the University of Gothenburg, which is in Sweden. Now, we know that if you have a stroke, and please make a note of this, if you have a stroke, one of the very first things you should do is insist that hyperbaric oxygen therapy is what you should have, because we know that helps slow down and reverse many of the factors that cause damage within the brain after a stroke. It can save people's lives. But also, hyperbaric oxygen therapy can relieve self-reported symptoms and side effects of radiation therapy. For example, let's say that you've had radiation therapy for cancer. A study shows that you get a higher benefit when you're in a hyperbaric chamber after that. It can reduce bleeding, urinary incontinence, pain, etc. Just a therapy that's been underused, I believe, for a lot of important therapies. And green tea and carrots can restore working memory in dementia patients. Who says? University of Southern California, published in the Journal of Biological Chemistry. I would suggest between 800 to 1200 milligrams of non-caffeinated EGCG or green tea. And you're not going to be able to drink that much, but you want what is called ferulic acid, F-E-R-U-L-I-C, and that's found in carrots and oats and rice and tomatoes and wheat. Taking the two together can help with Alzheimer's. And the linoleic acid, lino, L-I-N-O, leic, L-E-I-C, acid, can reduce the risk of heart disease, according to research, University of South Dakota. Now, what do I mean? Well, the linoleic acid is an omega-6 fatty acid, and they have long been deemed as bad fats, like arachidonic acid for meat. And this is due to the belief that having more omega-6 fatty acids than omega-3 fatty acids increases a person's risk of heart disease. It is also predicted on the idea that predicated on the idea that the omega-6 fatty acids are pro-inflammatory and give rise to inflammatory molecules. However, new studies are showing that the omega-6 fatty acids are not associated with higher risk of cardiovascular disease. In fact, they can help lower the risk of cardiovascular disease and death and stroke. But make sure that you get them from the unrefined oils, not the clarified oils, not the bleached oils, but the crude extra virgin oils, like if you had some safflower oil, but it should be unrefined, cold pressed. The refined oils, I wouldn't suggest any because they are pro-inflammatory. So it's just like a carbohydrate. If a carbohydrate is brown rice, that's good for you. If it's whole grain, still cut oatmeal, that's good for you. But if you have white rice, it's not good for you. So it's not just a carbohydrate, it's whether it's refined or whole. And this research was also done at the Sanford School of Medicine at University of South Dakota. And just a way of helping our hearts. And finally, genistein, geni, G-E-N-I, steen, S-T-E-I-N, that's in soy, and it helps your bones remineralize better than medications. And about 40 million U.S. women over the age of 50, generally past the age of natural menopause, are engaged in, unfortunately, synthetic hormone replacement therapy, which I never agree to. Personalized bioidentical hormones, yes. But one of the first things you start seeing is demineralization of the bones when you're past menopause. And so people go out and take Foxamax and Avista and hormones like estradiol, estrogen, and those are not, in my opinion, safe. The studies show that. And so I don't believe we should be medicalizing a non-problem. So the marketing of drugs for conditions rather than looking at how we can actually deal with those conditions naturally, that's where the battle has been. And unfortunately, Big Pharma has won that battle. I'm Gary Null. We are 20 minutes into our program. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, we're going to go directly to an audio clip. In fact, I'm going to play two audio clips back to back. One of those audio clips is with the CIA admitting they use the and manipulate the American media. Now, mind you, this is 1974, and now they're doing it everywhere, actually hiring Brennan and hiring these other people, Clapper, head of intelligence agencies, that A, they lied before Congress, and B, they're misinformation experts. Then we're going to go from there to my commentary, and then we're going to have Cheryl Atkinson talk about what happened to the $91 billion for hurricane recovery in Puerto Rico. I have a lot of people from the Dominican Republic, Haiti, Puerto Rico, Trinidad, Jamaica, listen to the program, have for decades. And so I was asked this question, why didn't we get the recovery? So today you're going to find out why you didn't get the recovery. Back in a moment. Please stay with us.
That it was a matter of real concern that planted stories intended to serve a national purpose abroad came home and were circulated here and believed here, because this would mean that the CIA could manipulate the news in the United States by channeling it through some foreign country. Now, we're looking at that very carefully.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to a major circulation American journal?
We do have people who submit pieces to other two American journals.
Do you have any people paid by the CIA who are working for television networks?
This, I think, gets into the kind of getting into the details, Mr. Chairman, that I'd like to get into in executive session.
At CBS, we had been contacted by the CIA. As a matter of fact, by the time I became the head of the whole news and public affairs operation in 1954, ships had been established, and I was told about them and asked if I'd carry on with them.
We have quite a lot of detailed information, and we will evaluate it, and we will include any evidence of wrongdoing or any evidence of impropriety in our final report and make recommendations.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to the national news services, AP and UPI?
Well, again, I think we're getting into the kind of detail, Mr. Chairman, that I'd prefer to handle in executive session.
If you could give us a quick update on the never-ending, constant assaults and attacks on President Trump's, well, presidency, based on what so far has been entirely invention, and somehow it's getting traction. And even this impeachment thing is crazy. I mean, anyway, what's the state of things now? Because, again, stuff is coming from all sides. That all you can really get out of it is sort of fatigue of the issues and cognitive dissonance.
Yeah, it's just it's a continuation of the same thing. This is all of this is just it's the exact same thing that the Mueller investigation was and that the FISA warrant was. It's all a continuation of that. It's just invent something. And, you know, throw the mud against the wall and see what sticks. And they've just tried thing after thing after thing after thing, and it hasn't worked. And so The Democrats think they're getting a lot more traction with this Ukraine thing, so they've decided to go all in on this. But also, as we've talked about many times, the clock is ticking. And you've got U.S. Attorney General Barr is now traveling all over the world, back to London and to Italy and all these places that were involved in this invention of the Steele dossier, the political document, and how all of this was manipulated to try and target a political enemy, which of course was the Trump campaign. So all of that investigation is taking place at a furious pace, and it's going to come out fairly soon. So that clock is ticking. All the Democrats know it. So this is the last big gasp, unless they can come up with some other, you know, shiny object that looks like it's a great idea to attack Trump. This is the last big gasp. And so they're pulling out all the stops. And I would just say, you can see who the desperate people are. And we've seen, I believe it was yesterday or maybe the day before, but we just saw former CIA director John Brennan out on national news saying, please, anybody else out there that can be a whistleblower, please step forward. Come on, now's the time. You know, pile on. This is our last chance. You know, now I'm paraphrasing, but, this is our last chance to get Trump. So come on, guys. And so you've got this desperate plea on his part, which is echoed within the Democratic Party and other places. And it looks like what we've seen is them, you know, Adam Schiff's office wrote, one of his staffers wrote apparently the actual complaint, the whistleblower complaint, the original one. And so they're trying to get these guys in, and they're going to, you know, dust them off and put written papers in their hands and have them sign them and shuffle them forward to try and convince the public that Trump is guilty of all this stuff. Now, they're coming out with their own polling saying that, oh, this is winning and we're really doing great. So I'm telling you, true. I know for a fact Democrats on the Hill are very excited about this. But, you know, you step back, take a look at it, and you start looking at some of the other polls. And I think the majority of the United States of America are pissed off at this whole thing. They're tired of all this BS. Every time we get to the bottom of it, there's nothing there. It's all nothing burger all the way through. And this is just one more case of it. Everybody sees it. You know, they're all saying, oh, there's all this secret stuff. And Schiff makes up this whole story about what was in this conversation with Ukraine, the president of Ukraine. And Trump releases the transcript and none of it's there. So it's just once again, you see, it's all BS, this worn out script that's just, you know, used over and over and over and over and over. And the reason you're seeing it, particularly by like John.
Okay, so here is the point of that. As anyone listening to this program knows, I oppose the presidency of Donald Trump for a simple reason. I feel he's unqualified at every single level. And I've said from the very beginning, don't put all your energy on Trump. He'll destroy himself. He is fully capable of that, as we've seen, not just with some occasional gaffes, as Joe Biden does. But the man simply is a functional illiterate, in my opinion. However, go back a moment and put this in perspective. Every single one of the most corrupt, dominant, neoliberal industries, the military-industrial complex, the medical-industrial complex, including big pharma, big oil, big gas, hydrofracking, the privatization of water, the privatization, Wall Street, with all of its equity partners buying up companies, stripping off their assets and firing employees and moving it overseas. The entire banking society, all of them, every single one of them, including all the major media in America, all supported Hillary Clinton. That should have been a big red flag. The Clintons did NAFTA and destroyed much of the union and quality of life and collective bargaining for the average working class person. And now we know how many things she did in secret that came out through the WikiLeaks. While she's saying we want the union vote, she had 41 separate countries that she was pitching the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and that's NAFTA on steroids. So when everybody who is really, really the problem, including those that pollute our environment, are on your side, that's not a good thing. And nobody was for Trump. Now, if you take a careful look, the deep state has come out because of Trump and to stop him because they can't control him. even though he has a lot of these terrible people, almost all terrible people around him and in his administration, but Bernie Sanders could run against Trump tomorrow and win, and at least there'd be some semblance. Bernie Sanders is by no measure perfect, but he's a lot better than Trump and a lot better than any of the other Democrats, with the exception of Tulsi Gabbard. That would be a great ticket, those two. At least I would have some confidence that working class people, students, the environment, and domestic policies at least would be brought to a more level that we could live with. On his foreign policies, he's still a war person. So the CIA has done all it can to stop Trump. If we don't like someone that's elected, wait till the next election and vote him out. That's the real way of doing it. But right in clear view, all the major media, the New York Times, the Washington Post, all these publications are going after Trump based upon false allegations. If you want to go after him based upon his character flaws, his lack of business acumen, all of his bankruptcies, you know, his lack of moral fiber, that's fine. But when you go after him based upon what he didn't do, that's not fine. And they should have looked into Hillary Clinton's working with Russia, getting $120 million to the Clinton Foundation after America, through Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, gave away 20% of all of our uranium in that deal. Not a word. You should also take a look at what really happened with Benghazi, where Christopher Stevens and four other people died because Hillary Clinton, the CIA, were running guns and all forms of munitions from Gaddafi through the Libyan annex that had no security, and then into Turkey. And then Turkey was then arming, training, funding, along with Saudi Arabia, ISIS, ISIL, Al-Qaeda, al-Nusra, all terrorists, all head choppers. And if that would have come out at the hearings where Hillary Clinton was, then we would have been really in a hot spot. We would be shown publicly and under oath to be supporting terrorism, the very thing that we're spending billions of dollars a year, hundreds of billions of dollars a year, supposedly to control, and we're actually creating it. Barack Obama created ISIS. That's a reality. You never hear anyone talking about that. You never hear any person questioning whether or not Barack Obama deserved the Nobel Peace Prize, since he was engaged in more wars and caused more death than any other president in American history. So, and then the Steele report, a completely made up dossier paid for by Hillary Clinton, the Democratic National Committee, and a law firm. Everything in there was fabricated. And that fabrication was known to the FBI, known to Comey, prior to Mueller. And therefore, it should never have happened. If you want to take someone out of office, take them out of the ballot box. If a person has been shown to commit crimes, bring those crimes through the Justice Department and let that person be prosecuted. But don't think that somehow the American public is dumb enough, gullible enough, to believe what this media campaign does nonstop. And then yesterday, Veritas group had a person inside for 2 years. They actually didn't have the person. The person came to Veritas because he was so disappointed about the complete politicalization of the news. And Zucker, who heads CNN, 8 and 9 o'clock every morning, they have these meetings. And in these meetings, he, the president of the network, CNN, tells people what they have to write on. And it's all about impeach Trump, impeach Trump, impeach Trump. But what about all the other news? What about reporting actual reporting news? That's not important. It's Trump every second of every day. Rachel Maddow and the rest of those dancing clowns over on MSNBC, same thing. So what we're seeing is a coup, a real-time coup in the United States against a dysfunctional and deplorable president. But we're not a democracy. We're not a republic. We're not even decent if we allow that to happen. Don't like Trump? Good. I don't either. Vote him out. But don't have the deep state, the CIA, the National Security Agency, the people who run these, and controlling the media, telling us our truths, because they are pathologically lying about everything. And by the way, I think it was ABC was called out this week for showing what was going on in Syria and it wasn't in the munitions and all that going off. It was not in Syria. It was a gun range in the United States. Remember earlier this year, I broadcast a video, and in it you see an empty room, and you see a camera that's on 24/7 out a window at a building and maybe 300 yards away. And then suddenly there are people in the room and they're talking about what's going to happen. And then suddenly there's an explosion and you see this fireball. Well, it turns out they were trying to make that seem like, and that was CNN, that they were in a fire zone in a war in near Aleppo. And then another camera goes around, a local camera, and shows that these are just local townspeople. There was a break in an oil pump, and they were going down and getting oil for themselves. Hundreds of people were taking barrels and scooping up oil. And then someone put it on fire to make it look like it was in a war zone. They're manufacturing the consent that somehow this is real when it's not. We have enough crisis in the world. We have enough tragedy in the world. We have enough suffering in the world. And yet the permanent war state, the people like Elizabeth Warren and others who fund war without ever challenging it, but won't fund the de-ghettoization of a neighborhood, won't fund public education for teachers to really do their job and give them good working conditions. They put it all on the corrupt management and professionals that we don't need. Everything you could do wrong, these are the people doing it. I just wanted to share that with you and show that it's not new. Went back to 1974 and before that as well. We're going to take a break and come back, and I'm going to do the next part of our article challenging the bias within Wikipedia. Please stay with us. Oh, by the way, before we do that, write down these numbers so that if there's ever a problem, you can go to these numbers. And those of you listening over the internet and those of you downloading the show, it should be much clearer today because we put in new computer cards in our New York office yesterday to make it better. Here is our live listen number, 774-337-6068, 774-337-6068. And also we have another listen live number, if that should be busy, because people are going on. Over the weekend, I think it was 13,000 in 1 hour went downloaded a show. The other number is 605-562-7900, 605-562-7900. And our archive number is 701-719-9976, 701-719-9976. Back in a moment with our special report, the conclusion of that special report. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you. I'm Gary Null. Yesterday we published, I believe it was number 52 or 53 in articles that we have written. These are scholarly articles, fully referenced. You could present this in a court of law, which many of them we feel will be presented, showing that Wikipedia, the so-called public's encyclopedia, some of it's, I'm sure, very objective and accurate. But on everything involving health, alternative health, is completely biased. How did that happen? Surely Jimmy Wells would be aware of that. So we looked at Jimmy Wells, looked at his background, looked at his objectivism, meaning his support and loyalty to Ayn Rand, a complete psychopath, and we compared Stanford University's Encyclopedia of Philosophy, talking about Ayn Rand, to show you what they said in their final comments about Ayn Rand. That Jimmy Wells says he reads everything she did, Atlas Shrugged, and that, quote, her fans suggest that her work is not worth taking seriously. And then we went on to this whole idea of altruism, and that altruism is that she said, quote, capitalism and altruism, meaning being kind and good and sharing and caring about the poor, are incompatible. So if you're rich, that's what she likes. And Jimmy Wales, that's what he respects. Rich, powerful men and women. The alpha male, the alpha female. But what about giving? And what about kindness? And what about charity? Well, they are incompatible, according to Ayn Rand. So if you're telling me that you're a big, you know, Ayn Rand fan, and you read her The New Intellectual, The Philosophy of Ayn Rand, and that's what you go by, my only impression is, wow, then I'm pretty much going to have an understanding of why certain things are the way they are in your profiles. And then we saw that he supported the Austrian School of Economics, which is just deplorable. I mean, that is, as I said yesterday, that it's talking about the serfs and intellectual nihilism thriving among Wikipedian communities, meaning they don't like high-level scholarship, all right? And I quoted Paul Krugman and Friedman, but now I'm going to go to Wells's medical skepticism. Jimmy Wales, who co-founded Wikipedia, may believe his allegiance to the philosophies of Ryan and Hayek, the Austrian economist, excuse him of ultimate responsibility for the intentional damage Wikipedia causes in the lives of others. His embrace of modern medical skepticism further compounds the problem. Here, Wells's favoritism towards an ideological dogma has contributed to the greatest harm. Over the years, a relatively small group, many of whom are non-credentialed, hate-filled individuals commonly known as skeptics, have been empowered by Jimmy Wales to use the site as a social media platform to aggressively attack and condemn non-conventional and alternative medical therapies. We're not talking about one bad therapist. We're not talking about one overzealous person overusing a particular natural therapy. We're talking about the condemnation of virtually every practitioner. You have people from Harvard, Yale, Stanford who have medical degrees who found that they were not succeeding using the current accepted medical paradigm, so they began to re-educate themselves into alternative and complementary medical practices such as traditional Chinese medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, naturopathy, chiropractic, massage, body-mind medicine, nutrition, and they found, wow, my patients are improving. And the test of this is some of these physicians have been in practice now for 40 years or more only using natural non-toxic therapies. One of those was Dr. Martin Feldman, person I'd have on this program. Now, you talk about smart. He graduated magna cum laude and number one in his class at Yale University, then at Columbia College of Physicians and Surgeons, then a professor over at Mount Sinai, published before he met me, published over 63 articles in peer-reviewed journals in neurology. He was board-certified in neurology, and he was qualified in psychiatry. And I remember I used to see this guy, tall and kind of gangly. I remember the first time I looked at him, he reminded me of Ichabod Crane. And so anyhow, there he was, and he comes up to him. He says, "Could I impose upon you for a favor?" And I said, "What's that?" He said, "I'm very intrigued by the whole idea of how you're able to get people well, and including some of my patients who've come to you, and I can't figure it out. Could I come and sit in?" I said, "Well, with the patient's permission, sure." So he would sit over in a corner of my office, and when people would come in, I'd say, "This is Dr. Martin Feldman. Do you mind if he sits in?" No, no one ever said they minded. And he'd just sit there quietly and take notes. Now, he didn't come for one night. He came 7 nights a week for 2 years, never missed a night. He attended every lecture, taking notes. And finally, he said, "I believe I'm ready. I understand what it is you're doing." And from then on, he took off and he took over another physician, an orthodox orthomolecular psychiatrist practice, and he began his practice. Many of you who were his patients knew he was just one of the kindest, most gentle, insightful, caring people imaginable, and he didn't exploit people for money. He was very inexpensive. So when you condemn alternative medicine and you condemn the thousands of board-certified medical doctor women and men who have spent their life actually healing people, actually getting good results, and you've never gone to any of their conferences, ACAM conferences and other conferences where they meet and share their newest insights and work. When you condemn every chiropractor, when you condemn every homeopath, when you say there's no homeopathic information in which there are thousands of articles on homeopathy. When you say that there's no proof and there's thousands of articles showing proof. When you condemn every single thing and every single person and then mock the people using it, that is not objective by any means. So although Jimmy Wells claims to be neutral over Wikipedia's content, he has nevertheless taken personal measures to protect the encyclopedia from criticism. In 2018, he supported a ban on the British newspaper, the Daily Mail, from being recognized as a reliable resource to reference on Wikipedia entries. Why? The Daily Mail has some good articles, quality articles, and they do good research, and they have fact checkers. Well, there's a sound reason to believe that Wells' banning of the Daily Mail was an act of conflict of interest and perhaps personal revenge. On occasion, the Mail has printed stories that challenge Wikipedia's claims of neutrality. One story accused Wells of being a neoliberal insider with the intention of destroying conservatism. Furthermore, Wells has sat on the board of the Guardian Media Group that publishes the Guardian newspaper, and that's the Daily Mail's major competitor. The Mail published a story about the inaccuracy of medical research originating from Campbell University, which in itself is referenced on Wikipedia's 20,000-plus health website pages. In effect, the Mail was providing a public service to warn readers about Wikipedia's unreliable information and grossly biased entries on health topics. This is all the more important because many patients rely upon Wikipedia in their attempts to self-diagnose adverse symptoms. It is also estimated that approximately 50% of physicians refer Wikipedia on a regular basis. In 2017, the Mail, Daily Mail, reported on a study conducted by Oxford Internet Institute from Oxford University that found Wikipedia had been relying upon algorithmic bots for over a decade, quote, to enforce bans. Well, we didn't know that, did we? And other things. And so this includes the undoing of manual and robotic edits made to wiki pages, a common occurrence on alternative health pages. And that's why if you try to make an edit on something that's wrong on health, anyone's bio, it's immediately reversed. And in 2014, the Daily Mail instructed all of its writers and reporters to never rely upon Wikipedia as a single source for conducting journalistic research. Wells is found on the social media website Quora, Q-U-O-R-A, where he posts periodically and answers questions from his fans. Per a question about the circumstance for the ban of the Daily Mail, Wells replied, quote, "My own view is that Wikipedia should be very careful about sourcing, including stepping up skepticism across the board." Let me repeat that. I want to make sure you understand its context. We should step up skepticism across the board. Hence, skepticism, the skeptics. The skeptics, all alternative therapies. And there we have it. Skepticism is to be the final arbiter for what can be ruled, quote, authentic medicine on Wikipedia. Hence, nothing of the hundreds of millions of patients, the hundreds of thousands of clinicians, the hundreds of thousands of studies validating alternative and complementary medicine are ever to be considered legitimate. Hence, the Foundation's board members and all of its fiduciaries are put on notice that Wikipedia is not objective, it is not fair, and it is creating original content based upon a skeptic agenda that Wells believes is correct despite the fact that all the scientific literature that we have reviewed proves otherwise. Therefore, we believe that all parties involved, from the skeptic editors to the Wikimedia board and officers, should be held legally accountable. Fair notice to all the attorneys in this, we've done your homework for you. And when we do homework, it is meticulous. There's a vetting process of scholars and lawyers specialized in this field, so you could use our material in any class action lawsuit or individual lawsuit. Writing for the Huffington Post, journalist Sam Slovic posed a question that many senior Wikipedia editors have entertained. Slovic asked, quote, Has Jimmy Wells' marauding encyclopedic beast finally corrupted the Internet? Has Wikipedia lost all credibility? Its purported neutral system compromised by toxic editors? End quote. The most toxic Wikipedia editors now terrorizing and sabotaging the encyclopedia's pages more often than not are anonymous, non-experts, and computer hacks who have ulterior motives and see Wikipedia as a venue to vent their animosity towards subjects and people they dislike or to advance their own beliefs and ideologies. Editors who adhere to modern skepticism are particularly suspect and now dominate upwards of 1,000 Wikipedia entries dealing with non-conventional medicine and parapsychology and doctors and researchers and health practitioners who advocate these disciplines. So even to suggest that meditation or yoga or body-mind medicine might have a benefit, you could be a target just for that. It is not uncommon to find skeptic sites praising Wells' embrace of skepticism and acknowledging him as one of their own. Sites like Skeptical Science and SkepTools praise Wells in glowing terms for his attacks against energy psychology. Quote, Wikipedia's co-founder Jimmy Wells this week reports SkepTools, quote, sent a clear signal to skeptics who edit the user-created encyclopedia. He agrees with our focus on science and good evidence, end quote, after giving undue applause to the success of Susan Gerbic's network. I believe she hung pictures or something. No background in science, health, no board certifications, no advanced degrees, and yet she's the expert in the world on what she writes and edits about? Whoa. And that tells you everything you need to know about Wikipedia. Quote, Wells makes clear that what I've been saying all along, the rules of evidence on Wikipedia are pro-skeptic and pro-science. If you're pushing an idea that science rejects, Wikipedia will reject it too. Paranormalists and pseudoscientists, take notes. Skeptics are not bullying you off Wikipedia. We are only enforcing the rules of evidence as clearly stated on the service. If you cannot provide adequate evidence for your ideas, they will not be accepted. So says Jimmy Wells, so say we all. Wow. So, are you saying that all science must be orthodox and therefore no one can do anything except continue what is, as if there's no more knowledge, no more insights can be had? Wow. I've never read such an intellectually diminutive statement. Medical skepticism is a radical aberration from modern scientific norms. One of its fundamental goals is to distort the scientific debate over non-conventional medical systems, such as chiropractic, traditional Chinese medicine, acupuncture, nutritional therapies, homeopathy, holistic medicine, holistic dentistry, holistic nursing, and then advance a deviation of the widely accepted evidence-based medicine paradigm known as science-based medicine, albeit the proponents of this latter fringe and rather small movement are not recognized by the wider medical establishment, and skeptics rarely support their absolute claims without unrestrained bias. Instead of following Wikipedia's rules to magically produce valuable and objective information out of a conflicting analysis and arguments and conversations, skeptics have been granted permission to impose their own rules and solutions for how wiki pages ought to be reframed to reflect their ideology. But do they have a background? Or are we simply getting their ideological beliefs? It's the ideological beliefs, not the science. Consequently, skeptics have succeeded in moving the boundaries that define medical evidence, and Wells unquestionably condones this. In 2013, Wells posted a comment on his personal Quora page and shared his experience at a London pharmacy where he was offered a popular homeopathic remedy for sore throat and cough. Besides writing that therapy, quote, is a complete hoax product, Wells revealed his contempt for homeopathy and offers his services to prevent its use. He wrote, quote, what I want to know is this, why is this legal? Or if it is not legal, then what can be done about it? Homeopathic remedies are of no value whatsoever and are legally marketed as cures for specific diseases. Who should I talk to about this in order to encourage the creation of a campaign to stop it? this is not my primary area of interest, and so I'm not the right person to lead it myself, but I would like to help, end quote. Wells also said, quote, well, since I live in London, and the problem of homeopathic quackery seems much worse there to me, I think I should meet people working on the problem over there first. And then he says this, that this is a quackery again. And then, lo and behold, we find out that a group of homeopaths sent Wells a lot of peer-reviewed studies and showed that he was wrong. He chose not to pay attention to it, and unfortunately, that's the reality. Oh, by the way, the Cochrane collaboration reviewed that particular and individual homeopathic remedy that Wells was calling quackery. Clinical trials were done on that remedy and found that there were four separate clinical trials we found, quote, suggesting that particular drug relieved flu symptoms at 48 hours, end quote. And, well, that's a contradiction because Wikipedia recognized the Cochrane research as one of the more preeminent resources for reliable medical information. But now you're not even using what you know is a reliable source to validate something that Jimmy Wells personally found as quackery. But Sloan Kettering Cancer Center concluded that the same homeopathic preparation, quote, probably reduces the duration of illness and patients presenting influenza symptoms, end quote. Oh, and that was blocked from being posted on Wikipedia pages. So that's where we're at. In conclusion for this, and it's important that we understand what we're dealing with, Jimmy Wells has gone on record calling alternative medicine, quote, lunatic charlatans. And that has inspired skeptics to create a Wikipedia entry, lunatic charlatans. The page specifically attempts to align with Wells' hostility towards these medical systems and notes this is Wikipedia's official policy. And that should not be accepted when you're stating that you cannot have anyone edit a page who has bias or personal animus against the topic or person, and yet they're in gross violation of this. I do not have time today to read the letter that we sent over, but make it clear. There is no ambiguity in the idea that Wikipedia is biased on alternative therapy. Wikipedia's stated intention is to censor peer-reviewed medical literature supporting alternative medicine's efficacy and will make every attempt to continue discrediting it. Wells, in effect, is shutting down free inquiry and free speech. Nevertheless, most of the greatest advances in science have been by people who dared to think outside of the status quo of the dominant paradigm. And one of the enormous failures of Professor Hayek's Austrian stupid school of socioeconomic theory is the idea of finding consensus to reign. When Wikipedia's co-founder Larry Sanger was questioned by Wikipedia's ill treatment of non-conventional medical practice, he stated, quote, Wikipedia's neutrality policy, at least as I originally articulated it, requires that complementary and alternative medicine practitioners be given an opportunity to explain their views, end quote. Good luck with that. That's never happened. Not when you have someone who lives by the philosophies of Ayn Rand and Hayek. And Sanger was absolutely correct after he left Wikipedia in 2002 and charged the encyclopedia, quote, with lacking credibility due to, among other things, a lack of respect for expertise. Wells refuses to take personal responsibility for the gross disinformation, skepticism's covert propaganda, and editorial censorship that plagues Wikipedia. Rather, he consistently hides behind the ruse that the encyclopedia is an open invitation for anyone to edit content, or at least to attempt to do so, and reaffirms his belief that truth will prevail through the chaos and infighting between unqualified Wikipedia page administrators and the average persons or even experts who attempt to correct erroneous content. Yet when an extreme skeptical ideologue is administering a page on alternative medicine, there is little to no chance in the world that any fundamental corrections will be made. In the meantime, Wells consistently reassures critics he is aware of the problem and that Wikipedia's editorial process is not perfect. Oh, there's a big difference between where you are at, Jimmy Wells, and your skeptics, and perfection. It's called a universe apart. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening, and have a nice day.